Now this is plain old tinfoil, and let's face it, everyone used it before when no fitting batteries were available. So you make yourself a little extension out of it, press it in there, and bada boom bada bang, your Game Boy works just fine. This hack is pretty useful and innocent, until one day a fuse trips and you don't have a fitting replacement at hand. Now in the past I heard it quite often that people would use tinfoil for their job as well, believing that it would act like a fuse. And the worst part is that they would even use tinfoil fuses for big mains AC voltage breakers. Now this tinfoil fuse thing is what I call an electronics myth, and I've encountered dozens of them while creating electronics videos, where you would think, this should work, but I'm not completely sure. So in this video, I put together four intriguing myths that after some investigation, I will either label as legit, plausible, or busted. Let's get started. This video is sponsored by Inductor and their awesome electronics magazine. Stick around till later so that I can tell you how to get a 50% discount on their magazine membership. Now let's get started with the tinfoil myth. For that, I firstly prepared a new fuse holder for testing, into which I then pushed the tinfoil. And surprise, surprise, it of course conducts electricity, because it is simply a conductive piece of metal. But of course, the job of a proper glass fuse is to basically burn through at just the right current and time, in order to avoid overcurrent or a short circuit. And when I say at just the right time, then we have to note that such fuses are rather imprecise, and their timing can vary quite a bit, meaning I'm not looking for much precision when it comes to the tinfoil either. It should just cut the circuit at a reasonable current. To test this, I next created three tinfoil sausages, which I pressed together with different strengths, varying from soft to hard. Next, I did an initial test with my lab bench power supply that could output 3 amp max, and as expected, all tinfoil fuses didn't care at all about this current and barely heated up. So time to get serious and pump up to 20 amps through each tinfoil fuse while measuring the voltage drop created by them. And after collecting all this data, we can clearly see that the resistance of the soft press fuse is around 3 times higher than the resistance of the hard pressed one. Interesting. And we can also easily tell that these resistances are very close to those of proper connectors, meaning these tinfoil sausages are excellent conductive extensions, which I hereby label as a legit bonus myth. But anyway, these things are still not impressed by 20 amps, meaning I had to remove tinfoil material more and more until I finally found a size that more or less reliably tripped at around 10 amps. And I gotta say, the way the tinfoil burned seemed safe enough, and its voltage drop behavior was kind of similar to a normal glass fuse. But then again, no matter what I tried, my lab bench power supply with 3 amps was never able to trip a tinfoil fuse. And needless to say, this setup is quite fragile. Meaning, all in all, I think this myth is busted. And before moving on to possibly using two power supplies together incorrectly, let me quickly tell you about Inductor, who publish an electronics magazine that actually teaches you really useful stuff, breaking down myths, explaining real-world circuits, and diving deep into projects that go way beyond the basics. Needless to say, I've been a fan for years, and right now you can get 50% off a 1-year green, aka digital subscription, with the code GreatScott2550. That gives you full access to the digital archives, so don't miss out and click the link below. And with that being said, let's imagine you want to power a whole bunch of 12-volt LEDs that all in all require 2.4 amps. The only 12-volt power supply you have laying around though can only output a max of 2.1 amps. But before ordering a beefier one, you realized that you got the exact same 12 volt power supply twice. So can you put the outputs together in parallel and thus draw more current? To answer that, I didn't waste any time and simply wired the two power supplies together like shown here. And after plugging in power, I was actually surprised that absolutely nothing bad happened and we got 12 volts on the outputs. Both supplies survived this, by the way, because they both individually still delivered 12 volts after this. To find out more details though, I next put a current meter in series to the output of each supply, like shown here in this wiring diagram. And after once again powering everything, it seems like pretty much no current was flowing. Nice. So time to draw some current by utilizing a constant load. And oh boy, this is where problems started. As you can see, one supply is always delivering more current than the other, even when we go up to our desired 2.4 amp value. This can be a problem, because when one supply always gets stressed out more, it will obviously fail quicker, which can short the other supply's outputs or overload it. And the reason why this happens is because no two power supplies are identical. The voltage of one, for example, gets more dragged down when supplying one amp than the other. And thus, when supplying together, they create an equilibrium, which not always shares the load 50-50. And this problem gets way worse when you introduce a different 12 volt power supply, like this one right here, whose output voltage is around 200 millivolts away from the other one. By combining those together, you now got a constant offset current flowing thanks to the voltage difference. And like mentioned before, the load sharing is even worse now. All in all, using two power supplies in parallel is still kind of possible if you know what you're doing. Meaning, I have to say, this myth is plausible. So let's move on to the third one, which has to do with these two adapters here. Now these are power line adapters, meaning you can plug one into an outlet near your router and connect an Ethernet cable to it, and the other one somewhere else in your house where you need internet access. And as you can see, that works perfectly fine with the adapters transferring your data through mains wiring. But as you might know, here in Germany, we have three live phases. And thus, if you put one adapter on phase 1 and another one on phase 2 or 3, then it will not work. Unless, of course, you put such a phase coupler between all phases, which, according to its description, are just capacitors. And that is where the myth got born, that you can basically couple any signal to and from a mains power line using a capacitor. To prove that, I firstly opened up one of my power line adapters. And oh boy, this thing is more complex than I thought. I mean, we got a bunch of capacitors, inductor rods, transformers, and much, much more. So to get an overview, I firstly wanted to learn more about the main IC. And that is when I stumbled into a rabbit hole and wasted hours only to ultimately learn that none of these power line IC manufacturers share the datasheets publicly. But while researching, I was collecting clues how the connection to mains voltage might look like. And ultimately, I found a datasheet from Texas Instruments about a power line communications analog front end. There they included not only a typical application schematic, but also specifically the line coupling circuits. And as it turns out, the heart of that is apparently a transformer along with two capacitors. That seemed simple enough, so for safe testing, I built myself an isolated 24 volt AC voltage system, whose waveform looks lovely sinusoidal. And after playing around with some small audio transformers and capacitors I had laying around, trying to inject my phone's audio output to the live wire, it kind of worked. As you can hear, the coupling to and from the mains wire works beautifully, as long as no mains voltage is there. After turning that on, it all sounds way worse. But if you listen carefully, you can still hear my injected audio and also somehow see it on the oscilloscope. So yeah, my filtering certainly needs more improvement. But either way, even though we need a bit more than just one capacitor to couple a signal, I feel like this myth is definitely legit, and I might explore this topic a bit more in a future video. And that brings us to the last myth, which has to do with such lovely inductors. You see, not everyone has such a big variety of them laying around with different inductances and current ratings. So what to do when you want to build a crude boost converter like I do right here, and you only have puny inductors around? Well, from experience I can say that most people have more motors laying around than inductors. And as you might know, no matter what type of motor, there are always coils, aka inductors, involved. So the myth claims that you can use a motor as an inductor replacement. But before getting to the motors, let me firstly put a normal 90 microhenry inductor in my boost converter, put a load on the output, power it with 5 volts, and slowly increase the MOSFET's duty cycle until I reach the boosted voltage of 12 volts on the output. Lovely. And since we know that the input current is 955 milliamps and the load is 36 ohm, we can calculate an efficiency of around 84%. Not bad. So moving over to the motors, and to find a suitable one, I firstly tested a bunch with my LCR meter. And it seems like only this BLDC motor comes with an acceptably similar inductance. So time to put it in the circuit and repeat the same test again, which to my own surprise worked out pretty flawlessly. However, the input current increased a bit, which decreased the efficiency to around 75%. To make that a bit better though, we can remove the rotor, whose magnets no longer interfere with our coil, and thus its inductance increases, and its efficiency in the circuit also slightly improved to 78%. And I know that this all sounds fantastic, but this myth is still only plausible. The reason is simply that the core material of motors are not made like the one from proper inductors. Those have magnetic energy storage in mind, while the motor core will saturate at much lower currents, while still being a whole lot bigger. Its inductance and coil quality also decreases drastically with higher frequencies, which again is not the case with proper inductors. So all in all, motors can be used as a quick fix to test things, but they will fail at demanding applications. And with that being said, we tested four rather interesting myths, I would say. But if you crave more electronics, then don't forget to check out Electro's magazine offer in the description. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!